ship was 150,000 long tons, 150,000 tons. We have these size, this size ship showed here.
How long was it, how wide was it, Ted?
It was 900 foot long and 157 foot deep. I believe Bobby brought him in here the other day.
He was diving ship and he went to this different area. The requirements is pods, anything over 130,000 dead weight or 900 feet long, we put two pods. Because of the limited space we have to turn over the basins, that, you know, we have a pilot watching, so we can watch both ends. This ship's 900 foot long. The basin that was turned in after it left out here, it just came off about, just what you hear, looking west, further into the next berth. But the pilots are on board, they're backing it down using this assist boats, the harbor tugs. Because the ship's a single screw and they catch a lot of wind. Our main concern is tug power and what the elements are that we're up against to actually safely back the ship out and turn the ship in the basin. We have little landmarks and stuff, if you notice the little ski tree on the bank there. That kind of, you know, it shows us the widest point of that particular basin.
That's New Ace's Bay in the background, by the way, just so for reference.
I talked about.
He must have hired that thing, we do have another pirate sitting in the back. Sometimes they refer to it.
Just so you know where they're at, they're pretty far back in the port, that's New Ace's Bay, you see in the background.
And this is all land there, up here, that's all small bridge, you know. New Ace River runs just a few mile, a mile or so, just to the west of what you're seeing here to your left.
And how wide is the turning basin at that point?
This particular turning basin is one of our larger turning basins. We got about 1,500 there. But they put a bunch of, we had also, where they put a bunch of barges, stacked barges to their college at birth, so they're taking some of that away. So we've got about 1,200, the ship's 1,000, or 900. So there's not a whole lot of room there.
This channel here is all man-made, the New Ace's River, just out in the river, you see there's the bay, New Ace's Bay, where the New Ace's River dumps into. This is all man-made, the cats on the ships are always asking us about the tide and current. And of course, there's no tide range here, it's only about 2 feet, the tide range. But this night's not having a lot of current, have to fight with harbor tugs, just the wind that we have to mainly deal with here.
We're pretty close, running down that much time.
That's Tule turning basin. Used to be full of Tule reeds, right? When it was a big swamp area, I think, wasn't it? That's why it's called Tule turning.
Tule basin, that's right, that's how they do it. It's on out as we leave the Tule Lake turning basin, which probably is what we use, just dug out made for turning the ships. And then they have the rail lift, one of the pig, the other ship captains are amazed when they see this Tule Lake lift bridge. And just very few of them in the world, I would have it. And most of the screen bridges are lift bridges. This is actually on cables that lift up, so then they look back up, rail traffic.
So everybody is oriented, the furry birds picture was heading west. And we're about northeast here.
Yes, real close.
So we backed up very, very slowly and started to pivot. And where does a ship pivot? It doesn't pivot in the center.
No, it's usually about a third away from the bow, if you're using the rudder. Now, depending on what tug you're pushing, the pivot point will travel up and down the ship. And if you get, you know, the same power exactly, it will pivot in the center. But if you want to adjust where you're going to end up in the basin, so you can put more power on the tug. You can kind of, you know, to kind of feel.
You see Captain Murphy, he's in the window there. Wonderful fellow, he's an ordained minister. He just preached at a funeral for us the other day. And he's the senior pilot, the one that's conning the ship in this picture.
The ship has made its turn. We're still in Tule Lake Basin, but it's finished its turn. And we're probably on a southeast headed, close to the east. And that's heading out of the water. He's like the smoke.
This is the latest toy that we just got here. It's a tractor tug. It can go maneuver around in circles. It's really helped us down.
You mean this one here?
Yeah, that's the latest type of technology right there.
So we've turned that big ship, the big ship is turned around now. We're 180 degrees approximately where we were, and then you have the tractor tug behind that is going to stay pulling the stern. Why are we doing this?
Because of the speed. When you have a vessel moored alongside another berth, and you come out of a vessel of this size, the water displacement is
150,000.
And as you move past, of course, you're pulling water as you go, and as you come by, you're pulling water. So if it's a deep low, there's nowhere for the water to go underneath it or all around it. More resistant set of your brake lines on the ship than at the dock. So you use this like a drag race car we use as a parachute. You're back in the tug to hold the speed back in the ship as you're exiting and passing out the vessel.
We probably average anywhere about 3.5 knots going through the harbor. It's slow.
Of course, it's dictated by the element ship. You've got a little high wind. You're using tug power and you sometimes have a new ship.
Climb up helps keep your speed down and you can keep the maneuverability of the ship because you can continue using the propeller. So you have good steers with the type of packing.
Both bridges just are exactly 138 feet. So that's real important, that's one of our big problems, that we gotta calculate the air draft, we call it, on the ship.
The tide is a big factor.
You know, like tropical storms here, we need to know before we leave, or we'll whack the bridge, we've all probably touched it a few times. Very happy.
Just with antennas though, only antennas.
They'll put you under the jail. Of course, this is the Lexington, which is a nice display in the jail with the aircraft area. This is where I'm down on heading to the east.
So there's the range lights too, Cafe East Range, you kind of hard to see, there you go.
That's what we use, if they're in line, it's kind of like an arrow.
You can see it, show the, I think you can see the other range mark, it's just above it, here you go. It's real hard to see, but when those are in line, we're in the center line of the check.
Use lights to navigate the ship, like, so you know where the center of the ship challenge, you keep those lights in line.
A lot of times the shrimp boats are out there, and,
We don't have a lot of trouble, I mean, there, and they usually work with us, the problem we have in Rockport, if it comes over, we get the east range, they're hard to work with. The way the ranges work, the after range would be like the tail feather of an arrow. The forward range would be like the point of the arrow. And if, as you're looking at it, if they do this, that arrow would be point this way, so they tell you to run the ship, you need to kind of restore it a little more. And that's how those flight lines are. And that gives you, keeps you in the center of the channel as well.
And as a good exercise, the next time you take the ferry, look towards San Jose Island, and then you can see them line up, and you'll know when you're in the center.
Naval Station Ingleside, it's closing slowly.
That crane right there will lift, what is that, 7,000 tons?
7,000 tons.
That's Gulf Marine at Ingleside. There's another crane at the Kiewit facility that will lift 14,000 tons. It's quite, it's actually real, that's a huge amount of weight that they pick up.
Island Orange Channel, or Caster's Cut, or Piper Cut, whatever you reflect those several names up.
And the reason I put these in here was that you probably read the South Jetty. They're finishing up the seawall along Charlie's Pasture. And this area over here, let me see if I can blow it up a little bit. Let's see. Maybe I missed it.
That's inside the channel there.
Oh, here we go.
There you are.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, there's a rock revetment that they're working on, and then there's machinery out there. And they really are moving along. And then this is eastward, where they, on the other side of the Caster's Cut. They're digging a deep ditch, lining the rock in there, and making that redundant.
Yeah, this isn't an isolated problem, the erosion along the channel here. I worked out of Lake Charles for a number of years, and it's been a big problem for a lot of ports because these ships have gotten much larger, moving a lot more water.
Just have the current toss it, smaller vessel.
Yeah, okay.
Once it stabilizes, it should be a little less dramatic to some. We won't take all the equipment. Although the island wouldn't be there if it wasn't for the dredge pull from the Diggity Channel.
Yeah, that's all dredge pull.
Not to mention the economical.
This is a marketing vessel. side, or she up the downwind side or down sea side.
Did you work a certain period of time in case you should stand or call the coach?
Well, we have a certain number of members, we split us up, and we work for 2 weeks on and 2 weeks off. It's what she was calling. If we're real busy, we'll have to set up, you know, more than one shift a day sometimes. We like to average about 1.5 a day.
24 hours
a day. We're on, you know, we'll rotate the center rotation. Ned's at the top of the list. Todd's next, first shift, then we'll get the next order. Todd will get the I'll get the next. You know, we just rotate through. We stay within federal law on how many hours we stay. That's at the bottom of the gangway, which is step across to the, you know, the, it's called a combination ladder. When it's just the, when we're at the dock, it's a combination. This is a combination because you're using the fixed ladder plus the, what they refer to as a pop ladder, as
a Jacob's ladder, which is also strung out alongside the east climb off of it.
And after you get to the bottom of the combination, you'll step across to Jacob's ladder or a pop. And the boat's coming in, like probably 8 to 10 knots, maybe a little less there. And he's going down the rope ladder down the boat. Which is a wow. And the boat will come in at the same speed, he'll match speeds, and he'll come in and send him probably step off and stuff like that. Zoom in, you can see where he's making the step on that one. So I'll usually don't break the ready. If you get caught in the water, it's pretty much over. The ship suction takes you down.
How many pilots this year, Bobby, you leave? I think two have fallen off the ladder this year, and I think one of them actually around.
One of the Galveston that survived the power of the boat capsized.
Yeah, all of us on the West Coast.
Of course, the West Coast. We lost one last year. There's about 3,000, 3,500 in the nation, is all there, you know, for us to shift. So we've got a pretty close brother. It's always sad when you hear.
We have a new pilot boat coming, too. How old is our old that boat? It's almost 20
years
now.
I believe it was 16 years.
I think it's supposed to get close to 20 now.
About 17, 18 years old.
March 20th is supposedly the delivery date of our new boat.
Right,
we're
cool.
All excited about that.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear. How many pilots are there working over here?
There's 12 ranch pilots. We have two apprentices. So we'll have a total of 14.
Now, does Port Christie furnish you? Do they charge the big boats coming in for your services? Or?
We do, personally. We're a private association, and you know, we're kind of like compared to a law firm. You know, we have to, you know, we do have to, we go before the pilot commission, pilot board for tariff increases and stuff like that. But we're governed by the Texas state pilot laws that was written.
So your firm charges the owners of the boats.
That's why we go that charge too. They have local agents that we actually send a bill to and they send it to owners, agents, and then it gets back to the charter. It's, you know, it's, but anyway, yeah, we bill them that.
Now, how do you get back?
But there's a tariff that the port charges. There's a tariff that the port charges.
Yeah, the tariff, the port also has it for their wharfing rates and for using their docks and all that. That's a separate charge that the port handles.
How do you get back and forth from purpose that you're going?
We have 14 cars that we keep online, personal, I mean, the association owns, and then we have contracts with taxi cabs.
All three of us live here in Port Aransas, and there's several that live in Corpus, a couple of Tarawa.
It's a nightmare during spring break.
Yeah.
Right up the beam chin during spring break.
One more question. How much clearance did you have to the bottom of that big pickup this morning?
The draft on it. I brought it in at about 32 foot, so we have 40 foot what we call controlling gap. That's 45 plus one under the core of engineers. So the different areas, it shallows up and changes.
It's about 8 feet underneath. What was that? Was that just 37 foot draft?
Actually, I come in 32.6.
Okay.
We bring in, our controlling depth is 45 feet.
Maximum.
And normally we have at least 2 meters of clearance on the keel, but it varies.
The ship channel is mostly cut from about 48 foot deep to 50 foot deep. The deeper ships we bring in are 45 feet deep. So there's not a whole lot of clearance on maximum gravity. figure you're in a little John boat out there fishing for redfish, and we have 3 or 4 feet of water underneath you, well, sometimes that's the same amount that we have underneath these big ships.
And that's the center of the channel.
Yeah.
You got different quarters. You got outside, or life, inside, left, inside, left, outside. So it's kind of different, you know. So that we have all those readings, you know. But it's called, you know, what you guarantee is 45 foot plus one is the Charlie depth. It's always guaranteed by the board.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned you have 2 apprentices, I guess, in training. And I doubt that people are natural born pilots. What kind of background do y'all come from?
Well, I come off the party boats and work at the staff, got heads off the DC.
DC.
Todd was one of the harbor tug captains.
Y'all remember the Corpus Christi phone book that had the tugboat, the red tugboat alongside the ship? That was the last tugboat I was a captain of. That's
right. So he kind of, you know, it's, I can't do the backboard.
Any source.
Lots of other pilots are.
Now, it's most all pilots, a big portion of the pilot groups are requiring more education. A lot of them come from the maritime colleges, from the West Coast, East Coast, here at A&M and Dallas. That's a good start.
The best training, though, is boat handling, tugboats, any small boats. The physics are the same, it's just on a bigger scale.
Yeah, it's a whole lot.
Any small boat.
Just working on the tugs stuff, you learn the lingo of the harbor talk, learn to adjust here to the radio. There's a lot to it.
Yeah, but you can start with a skiff and more things as well.
Yes, sir.
So your deal is the actual hands-on maneuverability and handling. When they come out of the academies, they're usually come out as a third mate. That's a secretary for the second and first mate and captain on the ship. They do a lot of chart updates, and really, they never get the hands-on experience of handling the characteristics of vessels. And then, so we, the ship captains that come out, we really have to go into a really extensive training. Seagoing tug captains and the harbor tug captains, they've already had all the actual boat handling experience and everything, so they're really that quick to get a ship's boat. So the education part of it and coming off the ships, they're trained, you know, anything within 2 miles of their long boats go down. So they got to completely recondition the mines because of the close proximity they're operating in coming into the channels. So they got to be completely, almost, completely retrained. So technical, not every, you know, the main group of them, it takes them a little longer to be a ship handler versus the guys up in town, small boat ship handler, or whatever.
A Coast Guard test is something awful, too. It's really hard.
When you look at it the first time, you think, man, I don't know.
It changed somewhat, but I said in 1980 when they had the Coast Guard station here, my cousin and I, Captain Nelson, he's a pilot in Lake Charles, and it took us 10 days to set for the test, counting the weekend. It was all essay and stuff. So the test has changed somewhat. You still have to draw. I had to draw a chart on rice paper. It was very thin and do an overlay on original chart and everything had to match up the beacons.
Yeah, draw the chart from your
scale.
You get the latitude and the longitude line.
From memory,
compass rows and the models together. Then you draw the chart out of your head.
Height of the buoys, the beacons, the numbers, the depth of water they're in, the distance between the ranges. This is all down to memory. Like I said, when your first thought of it, but once you get it, it's amazing what you can crack your mind. They put a specific route on our island to pilot license, Corpus Christi and connecting the tributaries, which is the Quinta Channel, the Rockville Cutter, ICW, and all the way to the NLR with Corpus Christi. So that's where we're held at this particular point. Now you can go and set for other boards. A lot of, if they're trying, you know, when they're putting their applications in to become a pilot, the different boards, a lot of times they'll put them in and set and get pilotage for more than one port. And then, you know, it gives them more than one area. It helps their odds make it fine. Like I say, you got a little 3,000 in the nation.
Are those airplanes?
each individual port has their own association. And we're, under federal law, our Coast Guard license handles all the American flag ships. Their jurisdiction doesn't extend into the foreign flag ships. We get our commission, state commission from the governor of Texas gives us our, they have jurisdiction over the foreign flag ships. Now, the Coast Guard will do the investigation and send the recommendation up to the port commission or pilot commission to take action against this. Of course, the federal government or the Coast Guard could actually file a civil suit. But as far as actually on foreign flag vessels coming in and really prosecuting, if there was negligence or, you know, whatever the size of the accident, the dollar amount, loss of life, how many barrels of spill or whatever. It is just, you know, that's the kind of how it keeps us in check.
Yes, sir.
I was talking to the fellow that runs the pilot book years ago, by UT and MSI, and I said, you know, the pilot service what boats, and he said, if it carries a foreign flag, it has a pilot book. One, is that rule true?
Yes.
That is true. Yes, what's required from the ship?
By the way, let me finish my question. Therefore, what ship can come through here without a pilot?
American flag vessel.
American flag
vessel. But it depends on the tonnage of the vessel, too. American flag vessel, if that captain has a federal pilot license, he can pilot his own vessel. Have you ever seen, I've never seen.
Here's what the requirements are for that, the requirement for pilots, for somebody to come in. If a tank barge, which is a ship or whatever, over 10,000 gross tons, cannot enter the port without a pilot on board. If it's foreign flagged, registered foreign, or carrying foreign product. The only variation from that is if a mate or the captain of the vessel is has the proper pilotage for the route that he is going to, and it takes a certain amount of trips in that before he's allowed to set first license and all that. But very rarely you'll see, because the underwriters on insurance and stuff, you'll see some seagoing tugging barges. The seagoing tugging barges are not now. They very just in the last 10 years, I'd say. Used to they were running right now, but the company has put the pressure on them to save money for the company, so they've all set for their license, and they want to be a pilot somewhere. And so they actually bring the some of their own vessels in. But any actual ships, even foreign flag, American flag. American flag with people with the license, they don't, because of the company policy, the insurance underwriter, or whatever it is, don't allow.
So the Texas Treasurer, I've seen it by Amy and Flay.
They take a pilot every time?
Every time.
Yes.
I'm thinking of the incident down in New Orleans about 10 years ago where there was, as I recall, the newspaper, which is not necessarily reliable, said that there was a dispute between the captain or a language barrier, a Chinese vessel ran into the hotel, there was a dispute between the captain and the pilot as to who was doing what. What is your relationship?
The relationship between the captain and the pilot is that when the pilot comes on board, the captain relinquishes the comm or the maneuver of the ship to the pilot. The captain is never not responsible for a ship. Now, if he feels that the pilot is incompetent or negligent, he can actually come back and take over the ship. When he does that, then it's all his. The pilot steps back to his ship. And so whatever happens from that point on, it's all the captain. You know, if it's possible to say, hey, look away from him. That's very, very rarely happened. Now, the communication gap between normally red Chinese is our worst.
Yeah.
Problem that we have with Chinese, because it's just a lack of communications. Now they'll say, oh yes, pilot, yes, okay.
Yeah, that was the problem up there. Whenever we go on board ship, we have a master pilot conference. You know, first thing is your ship operators, are there any problems that we need to know? That's where they had failure up there. The captain didn't tell the pilot that he had an engine problem. And that's what happened. air draft also.
I have to ask a history question then. When did the pilot, the association actually become an association, and when did you, prior to that, who piloted and how did you get pilots for boats in here, you know, before you guys were all organized? Do you know that? You probably know because your family's involved.
We believe in 1949 they became the Corpus Christi pilots, and I really can't answer the question for that. I'm not really sure.
And we have an old pilot sheet
from
1974. There's a couple of names on there that they used before VHF radio or AM radio. All that was all by the flag system. You know, the pilots have 2 year either airport manager or pilots.
You know, the channel, excuse me, the channel was dug in stages, okay? I have a chart, 1891. There at Fairland, it was only like 2 or 3 feet of water there. That was all flats, you know? If you can picture this, you know, Charlie's pasture is all dredgeable all the way to Ingleside.
Just like
these flats. And they used to, selling vessels used to sell up toward Rockport. And past the lighthouse was the old quarantine station on that shell bank. Y'all went up there trout fishing. Ships used to run up there and go around to Corpus Christi. But anyway, they started digging the channel in the 20s, building a jetty, I guess, and expanding. It stopped at Ingleside and then worked its way on into Corpus Christi. Stopped it at the lift bridge, and then they dug it all the way up to where it is now, Suntide Road, Old Dock 8.
Really, yeah, it's been most all the time. The actual entrance to the channel is run up and down St. Joe, back this way. And if, you know, the marsh, you know, the water was there, it would move, the bars would build up on different tides and currents that would leak on the other flood. So they, the local guys, the pilots, require, you know, to stay green, but however, you know, I mean, like deadlines or stakes or whatever. I'm just imagining which, from what I see on the drafts, around 8 foot, 9 foot was the deepest in 1874 or 94. And they went on up to Lydia and seemed to hold pretty good water because they had all the big tall ships went into rock. You know, they would come through here and she let the lighthouse hang up in rock, which means they did, like I said, the quarantine show and all that before they actually made Corpus Christi. And so I haven't done enough research to be honest with you on the gentleman that Rancis Pass had a shot at doing the city of Rancis Pass. You know, when Lydia went to Rockport, then they let a businessman in Corpus Christi on the North Beach decided that he had a shot at it. And that's when they actually pulled it away from the Rockport area and they had it in Corpus Christi.
Didn't I think there were some storms too that messed up the dredge going into Rockport, like Rockport had been?
No, I remember 1919 storm.
Yeah.
1910 storm that changed the road.
There's a couple of hurricanes back tonight that wiped out Rockport and tore up all the railway infrastructure.
Right.
And they started dredging into Corpus. And actually, Rockport was the big port city you played before Corpus was.
Yeah. If
and
you
they lost it.
If you run, if the channel goes, like I said, you would make a turn out here at Port Rock.
Oh, it goes from 258 to 270.
The reason that little dog lane is in there is because I think Lance County, Hood, Ace County was a little feud over who was going to help do some funding, and one of the counties was going to pitch, so they just run it. And so we make that.
San Patricio.
Yeah, San Patricio. We go around that, and you know, many years ago. This is why the town does it, this little dog lane.
Yeah, they just now got a member on the board.
They're just all politics, I guess. They back then when they were doing the channel, and they just had a stronger lobbyist in Corpus. They just directed all the main the merchant docks and wars and all that. Rockport, Rancis Pass. Military ships.
Yeah, we do that. We finish our apprenticeship, we're in the process there. We
do some educating at the base itself, and then they will run their ship 3 to 5 times with them on it, and until they feel comfortable with it. So after that,
there's some military guys.
Any larger military ship, we have to run. Because, you know, unfortunately, they put so much pressure on the captains of the military vessels, you know, from being an up-and-coming major captain on a large aircraft, they go through this, you know, the different steps. They have a grounding or any, which we, you know, grounding is, we might bother. If it's in the military, maybe they go behind this. Their career, it's a shame they put that much pressure. But I mean, really, it usually shuts their career down. There's no second chance.
In the photos there, we have three military ships, military Sea Leopard Command. They carry the railroad ships, been carrying all the war material over to Iraq. Anyway, they're based here now to do their maintenance and what have you. Those ships are 950 foot long. The big boys.
We moved a lot of several different units before I started. We brought back a lot of the returning military vehicles.
The military is built out, so it was easy to maintain security here. A lot of the channels were landing in Louisiana.
This is one of the last little turns that we had here. This is Collins Point. There's a university career, our office is just about to go in the world to live here. Product and for a refined product, it may not be mixed yet, And instead of taking a box by saying, well, I have bodies from them, you know, working in the cities or the same box as ship, a lot of them. So instead of tying it up with ship, well, they're waiting to mix product and get the service in the way of the mixing. They'll just leave it out on anchor and then call it in once the product's ready and they can pound silver oranges in it. They're never waiting for a bottle. We're always ready.
Speaking of the tug a few minutes ago, the inside of the big tug.
Yes.
You said it was new. Is that one of those that does not have the traditional screw and rudder? Is it chin on itself or like a
rudder? Is it azimuth or what is that?
This is the seat rod.
The seat rod?
Azimuth. It's like the outboard, the bottom of your lower unit of your outboard. But it rotates 360 degrees. There's no rudder. They just turn it 180 degrees.
Yeah, they go sideways. They're great. Really, we only got one, and we're really glad.
Actually, this is the first generation of the tractor tug. They've come a long way since they built that particular tug.
That tug was built in 1989, first generation. They're on the fourth or fifth generation Z-drives now.
Z-drive tugs. They've come so far. Actually, we didn't step out of here. We get all the jobs left over. But actually, they brought that thing. The tub was really almost like, it didn't have very many hours of use. It was designed to handle some of these weaker sections. It was kind of like Charleston. Yeah. Where,
there's
a Mayport.
We have four pilot mode operators, and this is the senior operator here.
He's one of the senior
captains. That's a picture of the old pilot mode, built 1931, I believe.
I'm going to put your pointer on it.
There you go.
Took these pictures, but this is Matthews over here. right?
Yeah, I think that was Carla there.
That Carla, and then here's the pilot boat tied up on this side. And then you can see it.
When was that, please?
That's Woody up to the right.
It says 45 hurricane.
Oh, that is.
What is that?
45. That was a good one. I wouldn't have that.
This is a bad picture, but I didn't have any other ones of the, from the air, but. Oops.
That's when they're building pileups.
And here's our channel and then UT, but that's changed a little bit since then.
Back up to that air conditioner, did it, where did you see it? I didn't see that one over there.
Yeah.
That's okay. This is the only income we're in.
We're pretty much out of those fixtures now, but, well, that's the mayor. We have any more questions of the, how much is it? That was a good question. Whoever asked that, does it go by deadweight ton to figure out how much the pile is you get?
You know, we do graph foot, there's a subtitle of graph foot, and we went to a block system. We used to go by gross ton, it's X amount of dollars per gross ton in graph feet. And then, you know, if it was over 130,000, we'd double it to, you know, there's different. So we changed that to directly. But right now, it's, you know, measurement, length and width, tons a number, and then they come up with a block system. Percentage of blocks, and we set that charge plus graph feet. And if it's a dead ship, the engine's running, we have to assist with a monthly additional charge on it. Yes.
You know, some of us winter Texans have scanners and we keep track of what's going on as much as we can. And,
I apologize.
And we all know when Sammy comes home back from vacation.
Basically, if you get on a ship out there,
the end of jetty, then you go, you follow that all the way to the go, dock, then where's the dock?
Well, our job is, the pilot boat takes us out to the ships. We get off, we climb up the ladder, all the way, we actually take over the dock, the actual navigation con, it's our responsibility. We take it all the way into whatever port, in its inner port or out to the outer, the key to a channel or something. And once we have it safe, we can tie it up.
In the Gulf here, we do it differently than on the East Coast.